the topic, you can see that how to improve your creative ideas and some brief definition about what is creative writing. So as you know all that here we have our panel with us, Assistant Professor Dr. David Rizal, and also the second presenter after me, Assistant Professor Reza Kafipur from Iran. And I'm very glad because perhaps we have reached or we got around 200 participants today who are willing to join. And thank you very much for your time. Now I will not talk more about the introduction, you know, the introductory part. I would like to talk about my topic. So here it is. In my second slides, you can see the image, the world of imagination. What is the world of imagination? We understand what is imagination. When we know imagination, the word come into our mind, we got lost in thinking and in can make our own kingdom of thinking and deliver those through our writings, which we call creative writings. It's very simple, not that much, you know, complicated to understand. So what is creative writing? It's basically, as I said, not critical thing to, you know, understand. Very simple, you can say it's an art of making things up in your own ways that will be distinct from others, will be totally unique, and your own creation will not match with others' writing. So it will be totally distinct from others' write-up, and it should be different. And especially in literature, we usually use the term creative writing, not in technical or academic writing. So apart from academic and or technical writing, it's totally the writing, you know, kind of thing that attracts audience much most of the time. Because creative writing doesn't follow any traditional rules, it's actually original and self-expressive. So what are the objective of creative writing? The objective of creative writing is to allure or charm or attract audience through human experience and their writing, they will express those experience and feelings about love, sadness, happiness, success, loss, and so on. So there are some classification of creative writing. First of all, we can see the classification of poetry. We have the poetry, plays, movie and television scripts, fictions, which are novels, novellas and short stories, songs, speeches, memoirs and personal essays. So first of all, I will talk about poetry. What is poetry? In a brief way, I can say that poetry is one of the literary work in which the special intensity is given to the expression of feelings and ideas by the distinctive style and rhythm. Like, as I said previously, that creative writing will be distinct. If you write a poem that will be, you know, totally your masterpiece, will not match with other writer's poem. Then if it matches, that will be, you know, plagiarism or something like that. So the creative writing, the content should be distinct. And the second part is the plays. We all know about plays. It's basically the work of drama, usually consisting mostly of dialogue between characters, and it's intended for theoretical performance rather than only reading. The writer of play we call, usually you call playwright. So in previous era, the famous writer, playwright was Shakespeare, and he wrote lots of famous plays, and we all saw that many people, they make it real in a theater. So then we got the movie and television scripts. So what is movie? It's basically a story or event recorded by a camera as a set of moving images and shown in a theater. Like I said about play, so it's not confined within theater. They launch or they play in theater, movie theater, on a screen, on a television as a motion picture. So next we have fictions. In literature, fiction is a form of prose, or especially short stories and novels that explains imaginary events and people. So the examples of fictions are novels, novellas, short stories, something like that. And next we have songs. Songs, we all know, we all love to listen to play songs. There are different types of songs like melody, rock, jazz music, classical. So what is songs? It's basically a short poem or other set of words that meant to be sung, or it's called music. Set of music, you can transfer a poem into a music which people can sing. And next we have speeches. Speeches is the expression of the ability to express thoughts and feelings by articulate sounds. For example, today I am giving you all the speech about creating writing, and I am articulating sounds and expressing my thoughts about creative writing. So next we have memoir. So most of the people maybe don't know about memoir, but you know about biography, autobiographies. So memoir has basically been defined as a subcategory of biography or autobiography since late 20th century. A biography or autobiography tells the story of a life, while memoir often tells the story of a particular event or time, such as a touchstone moments and turning points from the author's life. So that is totally different than biography and autobiography. It's emphasized on the writer's special moments or turning points, not only the, simply told story about a person's life, like autobiography or biography. It tells about the touchstone moments and the very special turning points from the author's life. So next we have personal essays. In a broadest sense, it's a written composition which contains information and personal opinions about a specific individual, usually famous and influential individuals. It is one of the most common thing that we give to the students in different levels to do the assignment, to prepare an essay. So this would be very familiar in school, college, and university. Teachers are giving assignments of, writing essays. So that is the thing of about personal essays. So the classification of creative writing, what are the classification of creative writing? Memoir and personal essays can be, write creatively in a way that readers can know about your life in different way. So it's something like that. And we write this memoir and personal essays in first person, like I, we. So that's why it's easier for them to be creative. So a classical example of a first person protagonist narrator I would like to share with you all that from Charlotte Bronte's Jane Eyre, in which the title character is also the narrator telling her own story. The dialogue is something like that: I could not unlove him now merely because I found that he had ceased to notice me. So this is the example of first person and as a in a personal issue. So in next slides, proficiency used in creative writing. What are the proficiency in creative writing? First of all, we got character development, which we know the characters are very vital elements or the part in writing. Creative writing, so character development is very, you know, important and significant to know, to show the readers what the story is all about through the characters. So the character development is the process of creating a character for a work of fiction such as a feature film, a television show or novel. As mentioned, is often boiled down to two kinds of characters: static character development and dynamic character development. There are 9 ingredients of character development. First of all, I would like to talk about communication style. You should think, how does your character talk, and does she favor certain words or phrases that make her distinct and interesting? What about the sound of her voice? Much of our personality comes through the speech. So think about the way your character is going to talk. Her style of communication should be distinctive and unique. In everywhere, we are seeing that the uniqueness is very important in creative writing. Next, I have a story. Where does your character come from? Think out his childhood and adolescence. What events shaped his personality? What did his father do for a living? How about his mother? How many siblings does he has? Was it a loving family or an abusive, dysfunctional one? What events led him to the career choices he made? You may not need to provide all this background to your reader, but it's good to know as the writer. It helps give him substance in your mind as well. So next we got appearance. It's not so much important thing in writing, like what does she look like? This may be the least important thing. An important ingredient to make your character a person to the reader, but you should still know in it your mind that not every character needs to be drop dead gorgeous. You know, the characters, they don't need to be attractive. By the way, most people are not. So it's least important. So then we have relationship. What kind of friends and family does he have? How does he relate to them? Is he very social or reclusive or somewhere in between? People can be defined by the company they keep. So this can be a good way to define your character. Then ambition. Just as this is the central letter of the arrow, acrostic, so too this concept is absolutely central to your character and plot. What is her passion in life? What goal is she trying to accomplish through your story? What is her unrecognized internal need and how will she meet it? So that will be the ambition in a story. The next is character defeat. So everyone has some personality trait that irritates his friends or family. Is she too self-centered or too competitive, too lazy, too compliant, too demanding to others? Don't go overboard on this. After all, you want your reader to like the character, but he will feel more real if he has some flaws, because we human being can't be without flaws. We all have flaws. We can't be perfect, absolutely perfect. It's not possible. So it's good to create a character with flaws. This is usually connected to the unrecognized need and often get resolved through his character. Then we have thoughts, seventh point. What kind of internal dialogue does your character have? How does she think through her problems and dilemmas? Is her internal voice the same as her external? If not, does this create internal conflict for her in real life? We don't have the benefit of knowing someone's innermost thoughts, but a novel, it allows us to do just that. So use to your it in your advantage. Think about the character's thoughts internal through the internal dialogue, that what are the inner thoughts of those characters, the protagonists, mainly the protagonists and the sub characters. So the eighth point is everymanness. It's about how relatable is your character. Like James Bond is fun to watch on screen. Most of us are not uber trained special agent assassins, so it's a little hard to relate to him on a personal level. On the other hand, Kurt Russell's character in the movie Breakdown is far more ordinary and relatable, creating a more visceral experience. But not to make your character too elite, be careful, or he may be too difficult to live, and that after all is the key to suspense. So make your character more simple. Don't make it too complicated to comprehend for the readers or the audience. Make it simple, and which will match somehow with the real life, not so supernatural. Last but not the least, the point is restrictions. More than a personality flaw, what physical or mental weakness must your character overcome through her arc? After all, even Superman had kryptonite. This helps humanize your character, making her more sympathetic and relatable. The goal is to make your reader feel something for your character, something good feelings for your character you should create in that character, that your readers will feel something good for your character. The more they care about them, the more emotions they will invest in your story. So if you create your character in a way that the reader or audience will feel something special for your characters, and maybe that's the secret of making a good character or protagonist. And maybe every novel is character driven after all. So next point is plot development is very important. Which means to unfold the story. The plot is a basic engine. We call the basic engine of a story, and which dictates the action of the characters and offers a satisfactory solution for the viewer. As we know that a story must have a beginning, a middle, and an end. Then we have the setting. It's very important thing, settings. There are six ways to make story vivid, to make the story setting vivid. So first of all, use details, learn from the others, make vital to plot, show time's effect, use symbolism, evoke the senses. Then next we have the fundamental theme. Theme is we call the underlying idea behind an article or a story that unifies its words into a coherent whole. The theme has been called the muscle or vehicle of the story. So you can imagine that how important the theme is, as we call it as a muscle or vehicle of a story. So then we have perspective. Like who is telling your story? Through perspective is the lens through which you tell your story to your readers. So it's very important which lens you choose. It affects your readers' experience and opinions of your characters. Make sure you're making the best choice in protagonist point of view and your personal preferences for your story's perspectives. Like if you have any personal experience, if you want to write a story, you can add your personal experience to make it more lively and real. As I, you know, I wrote two poem books. So in those poems, there are lots of things that match with my real life, my own story, and I, you know, put those experiences to my poems. So that will be the thing to create a good poem, good novel, and good write-up. So next we have a dialogue. It's also a means of exposition, communicating essential information to the reader about the background of the story. It is one of the basic ways of activating your text by showing. Then we have the next part, anecdotes. Maybe most of you are not familiar with this term. It is all about a short story or a story taken from a personal experience. Anecdotes can be useful for setting the stage for a speech or a personal setting, and often relays a story that can be used as a theme or lesson. Then we have metaphors and similes. It's very familiar to the students of creative writing and also the other branches. People maybe know about metaphor and similes. We use it a lot. It's a comparison. Metaphor is a comparison between two things based on resemblance. For example, the world is a stage, a sea of sand. My mom is a teddy bear. And on the other hand, similes is the comparison using like or as. For example, your eyes are like sunshine, poor as dirt, she swims like a fish. So these are the example, few examples of metaphor and similes. Then we have figure of speech. Metaphor and similes are in the figure of speech. So it's about in a non-literal sense for rhetorical or vivid effect. We use figure of speech in a writing. There are 10 types of figure of speech, like simile, metaphor, personification, apostrophe, metonymy, synecdoche, onomatopoeia, alliteration, assonance, and pun. The next we have imaginative language. To write a story or a writing kind of thing, write-up, you need to build a imaginative language. means if you have a good imagination, you can write a good story. For example, if I were a millionaire, or if I were a doctor, are two examples of imaginative essays. So it's basically a work of fiction where the writer uses his or her imagine to construct the essay. Then the emotional appeal is also important because is the persuasion method used to create emotional feedback or response from the audience. Then substantial explanation, it means meaningful explanation in a simple way. Meaningful explanation of entire story. So next we have the academic writing versus creative writing. What are the key difference between academic writing and creative writing? Academic writing is mostly realistic, but the creative writing is fictional and imaginative. Academic writing is informative, instructional, vivid, accurate. It follows the rules that previous people they set. It's candid, objective. The vocabulary is complicated. On the other hand, creative writing is charming, captivating, figurative, symbolic, subjective, and the vocabulary is imprecise. The same thing, the essential difference. So it's about, creative writing. You have to generate extraordinary content, which will be self-created content. But as I said, in creative writing, it is the thing that required rules. In science, we have the required rules. The scientists, they applied those rules in their scientific work. So they have terminated those things beforehand. But in creative writing, instantly you can create anything from our imagination. So this is the essential difference between academic writing and creative writing. In creative writing, it's for the mass people, for general people will understand creative writing, but technical writing is for some specific audience, not for the general people. So again, we can say that poetry and some kinds of novel stories that that attract us and transfer the reality we gain through our own experience, and we express those in our writing. So it's more lively and self-centered content that we share with the people. It's not complicated. The vocabulary is very evocative and eloquent for the audience. But in academic writing, it's, as I said, in scientific term, the thing is totally different from the creative writing. The style of creative writing is very much important to know about academic writing, because their style is totally different. The parameters are totally different. In academic writing, they have some required parameters which the scientists do follow, but the academic writers, they don't follow any required parameters. They don't follow any series of guidelines, or it's not a part of any curriculum that said it's rigid. Academic writing, it's follow strict procedures, and systematic. It comes with a systematic order, and creative writing is artistic, charming, with fascinating words, with concept, with deep meanings, and it touches reader's heart, and it lasts forever. If the content is that much creative and meaningful, then the readers or the audience, they remember that thing, that piece of art forever, and it lasts in their heart with care, because they put artistic stuffs in that. The academic writing aims is to explore an idea, argument, or concept, but creative writing is more personal. As I said, more personal experience will be added, and imagination in their writing, and it's fully based on writer's own creative ideas. So now it's a bit different than the previous slides. It's about what is sensory details. Sensory details is very much important in literature. In creative writing, it's all about sight, sound, touch, smell, and taste. Writers, they use this all these sensory details to engage readers' interest. So, for example, to describe a past, you need to do this sensory details. And first of all, the example of what do your favorite characters taste, smell, and touch? Because without these sensory details, stories would fail to come to life. So you have to make your character real by using those sensory details, like what is the taste, smell, or touch. So details should be included. So a universal quality is forwarded when the writer is able to personally connect with the reader. So you have to connect your readers through your writing, and you should use those details in your writing to connect them, to make your write-up more vivid and clear by using those. So let's look at sensory details in action. So here I gave example like through a passage. You can see that I chose to show you from my own experience. I can say that and bought on perfume. After that, I headed towards the fish section. Later, I realized that I forgot to buy milk for my kid. Now, does it pull you in? Of course, it doesn't. There is nothing, special in writing from the writer's thinking part. It's not creative. It's just simple. So now, if I put some sensory details in this passage, it will be more attractive to the readers. Like after entering to the grocery store, I was magically attracted to the perfume store because I love fragrance. That's why soon I headed to the store and found my favorite fragrance perfume. As I fancifully rested the perfume bottle in my rusty shopping cart, I caught myself as a queen of fragrance with the soothing feeling. While I entered to the fish market section, I smelled the stench of different kinds of fishes, which made my inner happiness or inner appetite disappear. So you can see the extra details made that sense come to life. Like I put the sense of smell, touch, or something like that. I put the sense of smell much here. that I love the smell of perfume, I dislike the smell of fish. So it is the extra details which made this passage more attractive. So what are the importance of sensory details? So it is the significant part in writing. The adjectives will play the very important part inside of your writing and pull the reader into her imaginative land, imaginative kingdom. It also helps the reader to feel like that he or she is inside of the writing, which create more intimate connection with the narrator and the, you know, reader. As I said, as the way I expressed my simply visited grocery shop in an artistic way, so I tried to connect my inner feelings with the reader, so they can feel that personally they were there with me. So language use in creative writing is very important. Find your voice, express yourself, and be creative what you are writing. So what is imagery? Imagery is a language used by poet, novelist, and writers. It includes figurative and metaphoric language to develop the reader's experience through the senses. So the example of imagery is visual imagery. We can use like the night was black as ever, but bright stars lit up the sky in different on which were sprinkled across the astronomical landscape. So like this, the visual thing is experience of the color, shape, pattern, something like this. And the using of sound is different. Like here I can show you the example of silence was broken by the chime of harmonies as Faria began to practice for a function. So here auditory imagery breaks silence with a lovely sound of harmonium's key. So this is called auditory imagery. The previous was the visual imagery. This is the imagery using scent. We smell different kind of scents like sweet roses through air and beautiful other beautiful flowers, and these scents help us to describe a sense which is relaxing, comfortable, and welcoming. So this imagery will help you to understand about scent. Those are the visual thing. Smell, this is the thing about to comprehend about smell, which is good, either could be good or bad smell. So then we have the imagery using taste. If you eat any chocolate, it will melt inside your mouth. You will taste the ingredients of chocolate. It can be, salty, sweet, or something like that, that will blend it inside your tongue and will, experience the taste. So you will experience the deliciousness directly if you write from the perspective of taste. Then the imagery using touch. Touch is like if you touch anything and feel anything, good or bad, like if anyone doing exercise and he is very tired, and if he or she touch any anything, then you will feel, that thing will feel or, absorb his tiredness. That will that will show through the imagery and explain the feeling or exhausted, you know, muscle or the sweat, the cooling of skin on that, you know, kind of thing, table, chair, couch, like this. So the types of imagery, as I said previously, visual, that what you see, auditory, what you hear, kinesthetic, what you feel, olfactory, what you smell, and gustatory is what you taste. These are the name of these five imagery that we can put inside of our writing. So here in a broader way, more examples imagery. So first of all, visual imagery is what we see through books, painting, images directly experienced from narrator's point of view. The elements of visual imagery is color, shapes, size, patterns. You can see color. In color, there will come, as we say in writing, that the verdant green or brand, you know, red, bright orange, dull yellow, Robin's blue. The writing write-up, those write-up will get more charm if you write like this instead of write simply black, red, blue, or green. But if you write that verdant green valley, that will be more, you know, captivating and attractive. The verdant valley, I have a house which contains the verdant green valley, like this. Shapes, we can say that square, circular, rectangle, conical, etc. And size as well, tiny, small, medium, large, gigantic. So we can put this type of name in a writing. Patterns also, polka dot, strip, zigzag, jagged, and straight. So auditory imagery is what we hear. It's about sound. How enjoyable is the sound? It can be good sound. It can be it can irritate your mind. Like good sound is songs of a beautiful voice, bird song. It is like good and enjoyable sounds. But on the other hand, the sounds which irritates our mind, that the bang of a gun, the broken glass which shattered on the floor, it just, you know, disturbs our mind. The lack of noise describing a peaceful calm or uncanny silence. So if there is no sound, so that will be somehow uncanny. So that is a different kind of thing, that if there is no sound and empty room, so that is called peaceful calm or something like supernatural silence or uncanny kind of thing or ghostly thing we usually see in a horror movie, that somehow they stop sound, which we call uncanny sound. So the kinesthetic or olfactory imagery is something like describes what we smell. It includes fragrance, perfumes, food and drink, odors such as rotting trash, body odors, or a stinky wet animals, like this. gustatory imagery is all about taste. How we taste in different ways, like it could be sweet, sour, sourness, bitterness, tartness, such as lemons and limes, saltiness, can be pretzels, french fries, spiciness, such as salsas and curries, savouries, such as thick dinner or a thick soup, These are the gustatory imagery. If you include in your story like this, they will understand what kind of taste your character is having. Like, is it sourness or spiciness or so on. So tactile imagery is describes what we feel or touch. Like, it includes the temperature. It could be bitter cold, humid, mildness, stifling heat. So the feeling of a person is can be expressed through this tactile imagery. Like, if anyone movement such as burning muscle from exercise, swimming in a cold cold touch, is it cold or heat? So significance of using imagery. Imagery actually introduces the audience into the experience of a pleasant thing or a bitter thing through seasons like spring day, burning summer, frosty fall, or harsh winter. So it led readers to connect and sympathize with characters and narrators in a very lively and in a deep way, and it helps people to understand the write-up of a writer. It can make a very attractive poetry through using this kind of imagery, and it will provide a very crystal clear writing which we usually can see in drama, plays, movies, and songs, even that when the writers or the narrators use this kind of imagery, then the reader, they are able to comprehend those things very well. So imagery in literature is very important. As I said, the origin of imagery is generally we found in literature through poems, stories, novels, other creative compositions. We will not find imagery in academic writing. We will only find this kind of imagery in literature. So, example of visual imagery in Shakespeare's famous play Romeo and Juliet. So you can see that I put imagery of light and darkness is repeated many times in Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet. So from the from Act 1, Scene 5, he wrote that about Juliet. Romeo was thinking about Juliet like this. Oh, she doth teach the torches to burn bright. It seems she hangs upon the cheek of night like a rich jewel in an Ethiop's ear. So you can see that Romeo praises Juliet by saying that she appears more radiant than the brightly lit torches, and says that her face, night face, glows like a bright jewel shining against the dark skin of an African. So the contrasting images of light and dark, Romeo portrays Juliet's beauty. So Shakespeare used this visual imagery to depict his character Juliet in an attractive way through Romeo. So auditory imagery is about, as I said, that about sense of hearing. So John Keats, very famous poet, he wrote ode rich with auditory imagery. Here some lines of his from his poem. So In these lines, we can see the animal sound in the above excerpt that keep appealing to our sense of hearing. We hear the lamb, we hear the other animals' sound, that we hear the whistle of the red-breasted robin and the tweeters. So kids call those sound as the song of autumn. So he created this animal sound to make his poem more lively and more attractive, and he showed the song of autumn through the animal sound. So this is the another example of visual imagery. I will go previously that Robert Frost, very famous poem, Stopping by Woods on a Snowy Evening. The woods are lovely, dark and deep, but I have promised to keep. So here he used visual imagery in the lines of his famous poem, and he showed that the woods are lovely, dark and deep. So here another imagery we can see in pop culture. We can found pop culture through expressive songs, brilliant plays, thrilling movies and television series. So here I put Louis Armstrong's wonderful, What a Wonderful World. This is a song lyrics. So here he wrote about nature in a beautiful way. He put the world, he made the world beautiful through his the example of example of the beautiful nature, the color of nature. He put all this in here. So here in this song, he depicted a beautiful imagery. Simply, he put green trees, blue sky, white clouds from the beginning to the dark night. So in whole song, he emphasized on the beauty of nature and the nature's beauty, you know, expressed through the beautiful colors. So he put different types of color in nature's beauty. So in apart from that, related terms we have also, as we said, that in figure of speech, metaphor, onomatopoeia, personification, these are the related terms. These are the same thing, metaphor, where the comparison between two similar things, as I said, without using like or as. Her heart is gold, the world is stage, the child is a bear, when he's sleepy, you are my sunshine, something like that. So this is the common tool that writers use as imagery, onomatopoeia. Here are the few examples of this. It is like sounds that imitates the sounds, and it represents the sounds through that in a double way, like the fire cracked and popped, she rudely slurped and gulped down her soup, like this kind of words, splash, pop. So these are the examples of onomatopoeia. The personification is very important and very interesting thing in a creative writing. It's the thing that nature or some abstract thing can get life through personification, and it's the attribution of a personal nature or human characteristics in a non-human thing. They will express that express the quality of human through those non-human thing, like the lips danced in the way, but we know lips can't dance, but we do the personification of lips and we made we created the happy vibe of nature, so we can put that the leaves danced through the lawn. Again, we can say that some another kind of personifications are, we can say that the wind whistled throughout the day. So the wind can't, you know, whistle. Human can do. So this is the personification we put. The abstract, you know, the non-human thing can also act like human, like angry clouds marched across the sky. The tulips nodded their heads in the breeze. The stars in the clear night sky winked at me, something like that. So that's all about my lecture. I hope you people will didn't get bored. But I tried to express my experience and the passion about creative writing, what I studied previously and still studying. So that's all. And it was my great and utmost pleasure to have you all in today's session. And I hope I will continue this again and again. So thank you, everyone.
Thank you very much, Farhana Haq. Yeah, it's a very good presentation. And
thank you.
All participants can also raise questions, but after the second presentation from Teza.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sure,
now I will, have the second presentation. And could you please stop the share? Stop share. Okay, thank you. Now, I will,